Thank you, Mary, for the invitation, and Annalie for coordinating everything. Thank you for coming on a Sunday morning at 10 a.m. for this talk with Jill, Magid. Jill Magid and Pamela Echeverría. Pamela Echeverría from Gallery Labor in Mexico City, and Jill, an artist that's been based in New York City for quite some time, and that I've had the pleasure and opportunity to work with in the past. It's a great invitation to have, within the context of the fair, be able to discuss with an artist and with a gallery the relationship they have between them. And I'm much more interested in galleries that have a relationship of long-term with artists that do project-based work, meaning artists that are not just solely creating a body of work that is a discrete object or a sequence of them, but particularly if projects that develop over the course of time, that have different iterations. Sometimes there's a production of an image, of a sculpture, of a video. Sometimes there's a production of an event. Or the sum of all these different modes of working end up constituting the life of the work or the constellation of ideas that, that the work or the project is able to crystallize. There's few galleries, I would say, that have, with so much devotion and attention and care, have been working with artists that are working like this. And one of them is Pamela Echeverría from Mexico City. In the, and I think that it's important to note right now also, in the last 5 years with art fair strengthening and becoming much more international, including galleries from many different parts of the world and certainly from Latin America is a key example, is that many of the art dealers, many of the owners of galleries, actually had previously a practice in curating, whether at museums or at their own independent institutions that they have created. Many of the galleries also had done independent initiatives, some of them artist-run spaces. So some of those spaces that you could see here in Art Basel, and as well as in some of the parallel art fairs that happen in the city, are actually initiatives or representations that come from a different history than the one of the art market. And that creating a gallery program, creating a gallery space, in fact, where a general public and also collectors could actually go in and participate, see the work, is part of a larger curatorial expanded interest. Now, I've asked Jill and Pamela, or in reality, we've conversed this, I think that they asked me, to not only have a conversation about their relationship, but we're gonna focus on one project. We're gonna focus on a recent project that was developed by Jill Magid throughout the years called the Berrigan Archives. I just wanna get a raise of hands to get a sense in the room of who knows about this actual project. Okay, so half of the audience knows and the other half not, okay. So this project, for those that that you know about it, you may have learned about it particularly through the press, meaning through the articles, through the reviews, through the different modalities in which the project has circulated discursively, and probably have not been able to have the opportunity to either fly to Switzerland or Mexico or even here in the US and San Francisco to be able to see the project in person. The project has actually been presented in different iterations across time, and Jill will be talking about this. But I'm asking you about who's aware of the project, not only because we're gonna talk about this project specifically as the focus for our conversation, but also because I wanna give a little bit of context to this. As I said, Jill is an artist that has been working through projects, and she has developed throughout all these years a group of objects, a photography, a sculpture installations, I suppose that a work on an iPad would be constituted as multimedia. So she has done a body of work that emerged from this, but I want to bring that project and make note of some of the projects that she had developed earlier on. And by that I want to go back to 2002, which I think is a central year in her practice, or particularly in the shaping of what would be the way in which Jill Magid works today. So, very briefly, the Barragán Archives, and Jill will develop this more, but very briefly, the Barragán Archives project began years back. And it began by an investigation of the legacy or the property or the ownership of the legacy and specifically the professional archives of the architect Barragán in Mexico, who passed away in the 1980s and who since 1995, the archives themselves, which are separated into the personal archives versus the professional archives. Professional archives have been acquired and have been cataloged and with very little public accessibility in Switzerland by a private collector. Julma basically does a whole research around this project, and she centers on very particular aspects of the project, one of them which is, in fact, the question around commitment to both access and to property, that she will eventually create one of the iterations, the most symbolic one, I would say, as an engagement ring, a diamond made out of the cremated ashes of the architect. She'll talk about that in general. I want to talk about how a project of this comes about. The ring, called the proposal, is actually not just an object, but it involves agreement between family members and between what we would call here a kind of absent party called the archivist, which is the name of Federica Sanko, who is part of the whole debacle of making this project. In 2002, just to contextualize, Jill had been living in Amsterdam, or she was living in Amsterdam at that time. She was at the Rijksacademy, and for some of the artists that are here in the room, you may know that the Rijksacademy is a very very interesting program, a very selective program, inviting artists to stay in residence in Amsterdam with the possibility of having a studio and a number of studio visits, and to develop a practice that has by and large been also project-based. Many of the artists that go there are artists that do work in the studio, but that also, as it is with a lot of the artists in the Netherlands, develop project-based work. Around this time, I would say that there was one specific project that Jill developed that I would say has created the path for the practice that she developed for over a decade, and that pretty much shapes the project itself of the proposal, the so-called engagement ring that's part of the larger Barragán archives. The project is called the System Azure, and it has a manifesto itself. And very briefly, I'm just going to mention what the project was about, or how it developed very briefly. So Jill, in one of her first projects to begin working with questions around authority, and specifically that dealt with surveillance or city surveillance, government surveillance, she developed many, many projects, but this is, I would say, like the start of a larger project. She proposed the police, the city of Amsterdam, to be able, meaning she arrived there as an artist, and she proposed them to decorate the surveillance cameras all over the city with rhinestones. And of course, the city police said, no, 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 thank you, we don't work with artists. Jill did not stay there, meaning she did not take no for an answer. And I think that part of her practice means not taking no for an answer is just a start of a whole development of a project. But she went back, and what she understood very early on, in 2002, was that introducing herself to an institution of authority as an artist was not going to work. Meaning that the ways in which one was to collaborate, if one so desired, with these institutions was to speak to them as their own. So she basically transformed herself performatively into creating a corporation. The corporation was called the System Azure, and made her little business cards, arrived in a much more corporate dress, and basically introduced herself as someone that was in charge of decorating the security cameras of the city, which of course she got the permission, meaning having been as an artist to develop a project was not accepted, but having arrived with a business card in an attire that was so-called professional, and with a name or with a kind of institutional backing, acronyms are very important in this, she was accepted to collaborate, meaning her, not only hired her as an artist, but as a company this year company that would actually be in charge of decorating the cameras in the city of Amsterdam. When I mentioned that this is a very important project for GIL, I mentioned it in a couple of ways. One of them is the fact that that the artist learned from very, very early in the start that she was going to play with her appearance, and that involved with her gender, that she was going to play with her appearance to be able to get things done, to get certain projects done. And more so when those projects involved an investigation of institutions of authority, meaning that the idea of speaking about access or public accessibility, or the idea of intervening or changing them, meant that she was to assume, to a large extent, the languages and the languages of the so-called other, of the powerful, I would say. And among those different attitudes that she would change, which would not only involve her dress, but the naming of companies, the business attire, and so on, I think that what would enter there was also a very important introduction of how she would relate to power or to institutions of power, to the relationship basically about privacy and accessibility that she's researched throughout her entire practice. During this project, Jill wrote a manifesto, and I think that this manifesto already points out very, very strangely to the proposal sculpture, the proposal dated 2016, that is part of the Bergen Archives project. Again, the proposal is the actual diamond ring that we will be learning about from Jill. She wrote a manifesto in which she tells a tale of the Chinese wiseman. And the Chinese wiseman, the tale is very, very simple, says to point out to the moon, and that there is a recognition of the unwise person that instead of looking at the moon that the wise man is pointing to, looks at the finger. And the anecdote is basically to distinguish between who's looking towards the future versus who actually did not get the point and is looking at the finger. Jill, what she says is, I'm interested in the person that looks at the finger. And particularly, I'm interested in looking at the finger. And to think that it's not about the actual moon that the so-called wise man is pointing to, but what she, as an artist, would like to understand, or in this case, the company, is who is the one that is pointing the finger? Meaning, what is it that that finger wants me to look at? Whether it's the moon or something else, and how did that finger have the power to actually be positioned? The manifesto basically is proposing that she's interested in learning who is the one that establishes thought. Not specifically thought as an abstract thing that we see there, but in fact, who is using the languages and what these are to be able to understand the world. So the manifesto ends with a question, which is, what ring are you wearing? Meaning, what ring is the finger actually wearing? So already in 2002, there is a relationship between Jill's thinking about institutions, accessibility, and in this case, specifically, about an actual ring. There's a lot to say about the history of diamond rings and the relationship to the meaning or the significance of them as engagement rings, anillos de compromiso. And engagement rings obviously come from a history not only of this philosophical relationship to engagement or commitment, but also to property. Even from the cavemen's, you know, there have been many different ways, many different reasons for why, whether it's bracelets or rings or other ties have been used to actually relate to the to being connected to the property of one or the other. But we're going to stick right now to discussing maybe the symbolic nature and the history of engagement rings or diamond rings as it pertains after we hear about the presentation. I want to make a second reference, and a second reference so that as you see Jill's presentation, you're aware of where she's coming from. In 2007, Jill had what I think has become more and more as time passes by, a very important exhibition. It was an exhibition that took place at Gagosian Gallery in New York City, and pretty much was an exhibition that gathered a body of work by Jill, still young, you know, for having a show at Gagosian, I would say. It was a bet, no, that the gallery had presented for a young artist that would gather a group of works that the artist had been doing in the last couple of years. Jill is one, I would say, of the few American artists that have actually developed a practice abroad, particularly as an artist doing public art, and then returning back to the United States. There's many artists from the United States, I would say, that have a similar practice and either choose to stay in Europe or abroad, and that just has to do with the funding, the public funding that's available for developing projects of this nature. Anyhow, Jill had returned back to the United States after a long stay in Europe, and she presented a solo show at Gagosian that collected or that presented a body of work by the artist. Actually, I'm going to mention the different works that were there, but there's one in particular that I think is important. And the work is dated 2005, and it's called Auto Portrait Pending. And the work was actually a proposal, meaning it was a sculpture presented within the gallery, that it had agreement, as many of the works of Jill. There was a sculpture of... So it was the sculpture, yeah, I forgot the word in English, I'm sorry. So it's the sculpture consisted of a setting of a ring missing a gemstone. And basically the proposal was that whoever acquired the work, this auto-portrait pending sculpture, would basically receive, at the death of Jill, would receive a diamond made from her ashes. Again, a cremation diamond. So the work is still available, we know that. Clearly the set does not have the diamond yet, and Jill is here. But she has indeed created one, which has already generated a number of debates. There are other works, but just to be more brief, I'm going to skip because we could talk about those other works that are quite important that have to do with entering a space of intimacy or privacy, which has been part of the of a long-standing interest of Jill, and that is part of her work. But we'll talk about this later on. There's other references also of that same year, 2007, that have to do with diamonds in artworks, that has to do with diamonds and rings developed by artists. But again, we'll leave that to discuss further on. What I want this discussion to be about, through the project of the Barragán Archives by Jill and the conversation with her gallerist Pamela, is I want to talk about three things. I want to talk about love, which is a very important aspect in Jill's work. And I'm not talking here about the engagement ring in love, but in general, love as the topic of a literary genre, love as something that you develop when you develop projects, and love as in the love triangle that this project and that many projects that Jill does is involved in. I want to talk about accomplices, the relationship between gallery and artist, and accomplices in terms of the collaborators that participate in the making of projects that may or may not seem to break the law, although they always seem to be within it. And finally, I want to talk about power, and more specifically, access. And in this case, it is to be able to locate the discussion around privacy versus property that very much this project and many of Jill's works are about. So that's a very brief introduction, and I'm hoping that we could talk also with you about other references that that will be inspired after listening to Jill and Pamela present.
Thank you, Sofía, and thank you to Annalie and Mary for inviting us all here, and thanks for coming. I have quite a bit of slides, so many of them I'll just kind of touch upon. For those of you who, I basically will assume people don't know about the project. I think that's the most democratic way. So the Barragán Archives project started in earnest in 2013. I'd been thinking about it even a bit before. As Sofía has mentioned, with autoportrait pending that I'll show next, the questions of artistic legacy and how a legacy is created and how it lives through time or is manipulated or grows has been something I've been interested in for a very long time. And when I learned about Barragán, the Mexican architect, Pritzker Prize winner that Sofía was mentioning that I've worked with, when I learned about the history of his legacy, which, by the way, I don't think starts at his death. Most legacies are being built throughout someone's life. And Barragán, if anyone here is familiar with him, was very diligent about the way his work was photographed and recorded as well. So I think that there's, you can think about this eye towards legacy from early on as well. But when I learned about Luis Barragán and the fact that his archive was split into a personal archive that stayed in Mexico at Casa Barragán, which was his house and now is a museum and a UNESCO World Heritage Site, that his personal archive was there and that his professional archive had been acquired in Switzerland, and also Barragán's work only exists in Mexico, or predominantly exists in Mexico. I was very interested in this split between an artist's legacy, between what is public and what is private, and what is accessible and what is inaccessible. And the more that I researched about these two archives and Barragán, and as I should say that Sofía, I think, touched upon, my work takes, I go into a very, very deep, lengthy time of research and meeting with many people and reading as much documents as I can to fully immerse myself and try to understand a situation or a context, so I understand the language around it and understand people's roles, because none of my projects are projects that I do in isolation, which is one of the things I like about this talk and this idea of accomplices or partnerships or collaboration. So studying Barragán's legacy led me to many other people and foundations who play a role in his legacy. So that will kind of come through as I show some images, but I like this piece that I wish I had it as a video image instead of as a still image, because it's a moving neon, and it says, what you see now is one of the two positions that it toggles between. So this is Barragán without an accent, with the trademark restriction. And then it toggles back to Barragán with an accent over the A. So it toggles between these two positions. And when Barragán's archive in 1995 was purchased by the Swiss furniture company Vitra, all of the complete rights to the architect's works were purchased along with his name being trademarked, but it was trademarked without the accent. So I thought it was very kind of beautiful simplification of this larger issue of copyright and intellectual property rights and access. And as an artist, because Barragán obviously is an architect or was an architect, but he's also an artist. I think there's many architects that are also artists, but I would say Barragán is an extreme example. And even on his tombstone, it says architect and artist. And I think he was a very beautiful artist. And as an artist looking at another artist's body of work, I was faced with all of these questions that I saw embedded within this situation of Barragán. What would it mean as an artist if a corporation bought the complete rights to my name and work and could control who was seeing the work and how, who had access to it, who could reproduce anything from it. What would that mean? What would that mean for me, you know, as an artist or for other artists that, you know, I'm thinking about in general? So it's really this idea of the role of the artist and myself as an artist and Barragán as an artist that was this very personal connection that I found. So this is the piece Auto Portrait Pending. This is a detail shot of it. I made it in 2005. And I'll go to this next image and then go back. But so Auto Portrait Pending is the empty ring setting that you see in this wall vitrine, and as well as three documents that are in this floor vitrine. And inside of it, the three contracts I will describe. So Auto Portrait Pending is a piece that's a self-portrait, Auto Portrait Pending. And in 2005, I learned of companies, there are a few of them now, that make diamonds from the cremated remains of humans. And I was very interested in this idea and the meanings of diamonds historically and culturally as having to do with commitment, power, love, status, relationships. And I wanted to use myself as a tool through Auto Portrait Pending to question artistic legacy and also, in this case, commodity fetish of the artist as their own body in the market. So in the floor vitrine, there is the contract with Life Gem, the company that I will become a one-carat diamond when I die, a kind of post-mortem love letter to the company, and then lastly, a beneficiary contract that for the collector who buys the piece, it's the terms of how it should be installed, because basically this ring setting is my own grave for my physical body that will go into this stone. So this is a first slide of what I'll show of the Barragán archives. I have a tendency to want to get into all details of a story, so I will try to shorten my presentation on the Barragán archives to give a more general sense. But as I said, when I was interested in the separation between the personal and the professional archive, and what I'd heard was the relative very inaccessibility of Barragán's professional archive. At Vitra Swiss Furniture Company, it's kept in a bunker below a Frank Gehry building, and you need explicit permission to enter the archive, which I tried many times to get access to this archive because I had full access to the personal archive at Casa Barragán, and I'd come to understand Barragán as a man, and I really wanted to understand him more deeply as an artist. But I was told multiple times that I could not visit the archive. And this is a piece that I made that's based off of a design that Barragán did. And there, it was for one of his famous chapel, Las Capuchinas. And on one side was a very large pink cross. And then the other side was this book stand with a Bible on it, and it obviously is setting up this relationship between an authority and a lesser authority. And so I pulled down that relationship to a more equivalent one of myself and Ms. Zanko asking for permission to come again the second time to see the archive, and the denial, which said, while you're able to draw from the personal archive, if you reproduce anything from the professional archive, there's legal consequences. You can't reproduce anything or else there's a lawsuit. So in this letter asking for collaboration, I had asked for a certain number of works by Barragán to be lent to be exhibited in New York City in my show at Art in General, along with works that I had made. And since I was unable to show those works, I decided, okay, I am going to try to show the Barragán works that I asked without infringing on the corporate copyrights. So this question of how do you represent a work without infringing on copyright? And that became a material of the show. How do you show something within the constraints of the law? that make the law visible. So, for example, one of the pieces that I asked to show was a photograph by Armando Salas Portugal, who was Barragán's trusted photographer, who took very beautiful photographs of Barragán's work. And this is his famous fountain, El Bebedero. As photographed, it is on the front cover of the Vitra book, The Quiet Revolution. And since I wasn't unable to show this photograph as reproduced, I used the book as a ready-made and brought the book to my framer and said, can you frame this photograph as if there's not a book attached to it? And another thing about my work is that I really see the law as a material of the work and permission as a material of the work. So, you know, this question of why is this book framed, not only do I think it makes a very interesting formal relationship, but it also raises these questions of the law in a very physical and visual form. This is a piece called Der Trog. It is that same fountain, and it's goes deeper to this question of what does it mean for a corporation to own the complete rights to an architect's work? Does that mean that they could rebuild his architecture in Switzerland if they so wanted to? So this is a question I met with many lawyers, and the answers run the gamut. Another interesting thing about the law, I think, and where I find it very artistic and creative, is how fluid the law can be, that until it goes to a court of law, it's speculation. It's a question. What does it mean? This is it installed at Art Basel Parkour. And this is an installation shot of the Art in General show in 2013 that I told you about, where when I asked to present works from Barragán and was denied. So this is one half of the exhibition. And for instance, again, to go along with this idea of how do you represent something that's unrepresentable, I asked for the Barragán Foundation to loan me Luis Barragán's famous Butaca chair, which actually was designed in collaboration with Clara Porcet, but it's often attributed to Luis Barragán. And I asked for this chair, of course it was denied. And so Vitra produces the miniature collection that maybe you guys are familiar with, that it's a very beautiful collection, and it's a series of usually chairs, objects that are exactly 1/6 in proportion to the original piece. So I bought the Vitra miniature of the Butaca chair, and I photographed it, and then I blew it up exactly 6 times and hung it on the wall onto the floor, so it's my attempt to show the chair that's otherwise unrepresentable. These are more pictures of these ideas of showing Barragán's work that are in photographs whose copyright is owned by the corporation, representing them, but maintaining that they're still books. So even the one where it's a framed page, there's a big page number on that photograph. So the origin of where these documents are surfacing from become visible in the artwork itself visually. This is a piece that goes with this one that again points towards this public and private. So you may be familiar with the font Futura. It's a font that's readily available to you. Futura is a publicly available font. We all have access to it. But Vitra has a corporate version of that font that's called Vitra Futura. And so I traced the difference between, it's hard to see here, but you can kind of see there's this outline of the darker font. So this is the discrepancy between the public and the private font through language. This is an iteration of Woman with Sombrero, the show, the title of the show I did at Art in General. I showed this at Yvonne Lambert in Paris, one of my galleries until they recently closed. And a very interesting thing is that any of you who are familiar with copyright law or the law in general, that law is very specific to its site. So what is legal in some territories are not legal in other territories. So in the United States, you, because of the fair use doctrine, I am allowed to reproduce Barragán's furniture legally as long as I don't say that it's my furniture. I say that it's mine based off of Barragán. So in Paris, where this was shown, there is no fair use doctrine. So you actually aren't allowed to reproduce the furniture. So I was speaking with one of the lawyers that I work with, and I find these problems really fascinating. Like, how do you make the law visible in this other context? So I said, I want to show the fascistole, but I can't. Can I cut it in half? Like, what are the possibilities to me? And I tried many options, and he's like, well, look, you can show it, but you can't show it. And I was like if I put a blanket over it? And he said, yes, that's legal. So whenever it's shown in Europe or countries where you're not allowed to present the piece, it's always presented with the blanket. And the blanket, because this is a question about the galleries, it's very important that when that piece is purchased, the blanket comes with it. And when it is shown outside of a country with fair use, it is always shown with the blankets. But the images on it are from Barragán's personal archive, and I was given permission from the Barragán Foundation, it's called the FATLB, in Mexico, to use those images. So those images are allowed to be revealed, whereas the architecture or the furniture design, which is a kind of architecture, cannot be shown. And now we'll move up to the proposal, which also took, the actual dates of the proposal are 2014 to 2016. It was a very long, quite amazing process, in my opinion. But as I said, when I got interested in Barragán and this split legacy, I was told through quite a number of people about a story about this idea that when Vitra bought the archive for its own collection or to maintain, that the archive was a wedding present. And the story as it was told to me was that when Rolf and Federica, who run Vitra, came to see Barragán's archive and became very interested in it and ended up buying it through a series of events, that when Rolf proposed marriage to Federica, she said, I don't want a ring, I want the Barragán archives instead. And when this story was told to me, I found it extremely beautiful. This idea of the body of work of an architect as being a wedding present. And as I was making this work, questioning copyright and access, this idea of the wedding present kind of stayed with me. And it was a story, as I said, I kept hearing. And so I started thinking about, well, what if this legend or this story could be reversed? That if Barragán were cremated, I knew about cremation diamonds, could could a portion of his body be made into a diamond ring as a proposal in return? So could I offer the ring asking for the public accessibility of the archive and the archive to be physically accessible as well in Mexico, close to the work, because I read a lot on good ways to keep archives, and it's very helpful to have it oftentimes near the work. So I was interested in this. Went into researching about it and found out that yes, indeed, Barragán was cremated. He was buried in his family's tomb in Guadalajara. And then years later was disinterred, the ashes, and they were reinterred in the National Monument of Mexico. And so I knew through projects that I'd done before that you can't own a body per se. A body is the custodian of the family or of the state, depending on, you know, the situation. So I understood that I would need permission of the state, but for me it was very important to meet with the family, the Barragán family, and see what they thought about this idea and what they felt about Barragán's archive and all of that. So this is a dinner that I had called the Family Dinner. And I had a show in 2014, a solo show of women with sombrero at MAS, the museum in Guadalajara. And above the exhibition, the night before the opening, 18 members of the Batagan family, invited by the patriarch of the family who had signed over custodianship of the ashes to the Mexican government, invited this group. I asked him, invite anyone from the Barragán family you think should be there. And they all came and they saw the work and we discussed it. And I said, this is the idea I have for the proposal. What do you feel about it? And the family unanimously agreed that they loved the idea and they wanted to do it. And they said, but we want to meet with you and discuss the terms of the piece. And this is a beautiful part of the piece that I met with the family, what would you say, five times in Mexico, also through phone calls, also through letters. And we met and got into, I would say, deeply conceptual conversations about the body and the body of work and how the diamond should be framed and presented. And that resulted in a contract called the family agreement that we signed. And that is on view when I show the diamond is actually part of the work. And in the end, the family and I are collaborators within the work in terms of our relationship to the diamond. And then once that permission was given from the family and our contract was written, the proposal went actually through Congress in Mexico, the idea, and it was passed. And a year and a half after that, we went to the rotunda in Guadalajara with government officials and a large part of the family and removed 525 grams of Barragán's remains. This is the urn. This is me in his house. I wanted you to see the horse. Batagan was an avid lover of horses, and much of his architecture was actually designed for horses. He designed architecture for people as much as he did for horses. And so this is a film still from a piece that I did called The Exhumation, which is the filming of this process. And I wanted to give Batagan and his family a gift for the ashes, because the family legally gifted me the ashes to use to make the diamond. And so this horse is a silver horse that it's pure silver, it's solid, it's extremely heavy, although quite small, and it weighs the exact amount of the ashes removed from the urn. And I presented this horse to Hugo Batagan, the patriarch, and said, can we put this back in the tomb as a gift to Batagan? And Hugo himself actually said, I want it in the urn. And he put it in the urn during that moment. And it was reburied permanently. And so this is the exhibition, the first iteration of the proposal. It was done at St. Gallen in Switzerland. And this piece is called the Tapeta de Flores. It's made with flowers and real flowers and fake flowers, and it goes into tradition, the Tapeta de Flores, that happens during the Day of the Dead, and it's a moment over which the living and the dead commingle, and this is 8 meters. This is it, a different iteration of it currently now up at the San Francisco Art Institute. And what you see in those vitrines are the documents between the government, the family, and the diamond company to make the diamond. All of that is transparent and accessible. And upstairs is the proposal itself. And I will say that I did in person physically propose to the Barragán Foundation that I was offering this ring as a gift. And in turn, this ring is asking a gift in turn. So if you do accept this ring, you will gift back Barragán's archive and make it accessible. And to say that I very much believe in art. Some people have asked me, do you think art is a relevant way to ask questions like this? And absolutely, I don't. I would not be an artist if I didn't fully believe in art. I wouldn't have made myself a diamond if I didn't fully believe in art. And so, yes, I believe in art as a gift, and Barragán's work as a gift. And so this is the installation of the ring and the handwritten proposal letter that a facsimile of it that I gave to Federica that explains the proposal and my position. And this is the ring. And this is a close-up of the ring. It's a 2.02 carat diamond made solely from the cremated remains of Barragán's body. And it is produced by a company named El Gordanza that makes cremation diamonds. And this is some images from the show that I did soon after that first iteration. So this was in July, and it ran through the beginning of September of this fall. And it was called Ex Voto, and you see another Tepeta de Flores with a pattern that has a reason that I won't really get into. But then I'd read about Ex Votos, which a votive offering is the silver horse that I gave Barragán. That there's a long, 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 long history of votive offerings, but it's a gift that you give within a grave that is not meant to be recouped. So it stays there. So I, from the old castings, I recast a series of four horses that will eventually be five horses. I'm trying to get to a close-up. Here's one. This is called an ex voto is something that is shared with the public, and it's a miracle. It's supposed to be like commemorating a miracle or a promise. And so I made these four ex votos. That's the miracle of the government, the miracle of the family, the miracle of the diamond, and the miracle of the horse. And they're tin, which is generally what ex votos are made from. And then I worked with an ex voto painter in Mexico, and I gave him what I wanted to be on the horses, the images and the text of what the miracle was, and he beautifully painted them onto these horses. So this is the front and this is the back that says the miracle. And they're basically ex photos. They're generally flat and they're narrative paintings. So they show the action and that what the maker is grateful for. And so these four were shown. This is the miracle of the diamond. And then when you turn to the corner, there was an empty pedestal, and that is the miracle of the legacy. So if and when the proposal is ever accepted, there will be a fifth horse made that will commemorate the exchange of the body for the body of work. That's it. Thank you.
So after that introduction, very clear of Jill about the Barragán archives and the different iterations, I want Pamela to talk about her involvement, not only in this project, but the way in which Jill enters Labor Gallery, what you see in her practice, and what is the actual processes by which and resources that you actually invest, present, work with Jill for being able to represent her work and also for presenting work that is not exactly sold, such as the proposal.
Well, I started a gallery after, as you said, having a not long but brief curatorial practice. I was also writing. And the first time that I had a strong experience and in having clear that art does have power, especially for asking questions, was when I worked with Santiago Sierra in 1999 at the Tamayo Museum. So I knew at that time that I wanted to be involved with this kind of practices that were engaged and based in research. I saw Jill's work at the Tamayo Museum, and I started learning about her, someone. I ended up calling her my wife, because we just, we talk at these very odd times sometimes. And that's the relationship I like to have with the artists that I work with. It's a constant dialogue on how we tell the story of our time, basically. That's why I work with the artists that I work with.
I think that you've mentioned an artist that, like in the case of Jill's work and other artists that work in your gallery, actually, particularly in the work by Santiago Sierra that you just cited, it's a work that involves human or human material, meaning people itself, in the making of the work. So maybe to understand where you're coming from, and we understand that you were there working as curator at the Tamayo Museum, but why don't you just describe what was the very polemical work, in fact, of Santiago Sierra that you worked on at the Tamayo in Mexico City?
We worked together. I was assisting Tayana Pimentel. I was not a curator at the Tamayo, but was my first involvement with the producing of an artwork. The work was 465 remunerated people, where we had to find 465 people that needed a job for 5 hours with a very minimum payment, which is something that is easy to find in Mexico. So we hired a company that finds extras for films, and they went straight to the military, and they hired two platoons of soldiers. And then there were 65 more people that needed to be there, so they went to high school and asked for students saying that they were going to be part of a theater play. So first of all, I come from a family that we have been on exile forever. My grandparents migrated from Spain for because of the Civil War, and then I was born in Chile, and we had to leave because of Pinochet. And then half of my family, it's like a leftist bourgeois, and the other half was not, more like a, on the proletarian side. So I grew up in Mexico una escuela fresa. No, like rich kids. I was going to the non-school with rich kids and everything. So I grew up with this culture, if you want to call it culture. And it was working with Santiago that gives me the slap in the face to make me realize that life was not what I was used to see in my years of growing up in Mexico. So what happened after is that the dean of the school got to realize what was going on at the work. After the opening started, you could see the difference in race, in social class between the audience and the people who were participating
in the
performance.
So basically, the 465 people, meaning the work consisted of 465 people that had been hired to just be there at the opening.
Correct. Without doing nothing, without making eye contact with
like
the audience.
Yeah.
And it was 5 people per square meter. So it was basically being packed as in the subway in rush hour, during rush hour. So it was really, it was tough, because then the people from the school took the kids away, and there was space to navigate inside the installation or sculpture. And some of us did. And it was hard. I mean, it was hard to have contact, you know, like human contact with these people that were on the one hand needing a job like this, and on the other receiving orders from a superior that maybe took the money for him, right? That's the way I saw it. And then seeing Santiago reproducing the images and selling them in the art market was also strong, because then when he was questioned about his practice, he said, I'm not doing anything differently than any other industrial. My position is that I'm a producer of luxury objects, which is absolutely true. He's just, you know, like showing certain aspects or things that nobody wants to see. did I respond?
Well, this is, you responded to the question of this is being a critical moment, having worked on Santiago Sierra's project, which, just to contextualize, the artwork or performance installation was part of Sala Siete, curated by Tayana Pimentel for the Tamayo Museum, and it was a series of commissioned projects with artists that were relatively young at that time to create new work on site at the 7th Gallery
using,
at the Tamayo.
Using federal resources too.
Yeah, really. And this happened around the late 1990s. And this is a moment of much debate in the country. And in fact, the use of the body was being discussed theoretically in many contexts, meaning the use of the body or of people as raw material for the making of work. So I think that's the context in which Santiago Sierra's work developed and where also, there's been a much debate in Mexico and about Mexican art of the role that the artist has in making use ethically and artistically of making use of other people's bodies as material of their work. So I think that's an important context to understand also the uses of the cremation diamond in terms of a process. But how then you come to Jill Magid's work at the Tamayo Museum yet again with a very different project, meaning at that time presenting a performance work as part of an exhibition of Magali Arriola that she had guest curated a larger show of the relationship between artists and spies, meaning when artists have become spies and the other way around, no? More so as a practice than as an actual topic of the work. And Jill's work was included there in both cases, actually, a work that she had developed with the Dutch government and a work that she had developed with the New York City police as well.
No, I think I just showed the spy project.
The spy project.
Yeah. And then the performance was from the novel that I wrote about it. Yeah.
Okay, and this happened many years before, meaning many years ago in 2011 or something like that, right? So I think that there's an entire decade there that between Santiago Sierra's being a turning point for you to understand the contradictions that contemporary art was raising, whether it was a luxury object or a social project, between that and having to learn Gio's work. So maybe to understand a bit is how... what happened during that decade, and how did you actually approach Jill, knowing that her practice was a much more performative-based, project-based? Jill's work involves a lot of writing, meaning making books is and being articulate, as we've just seen in the presentation, is part of her practice as well. So what happens in those 10 years, and what did you offer Jill as a gallery? Meaning you had already established labor, and approaching an artist with such a practice means that you actually offer something that's beyond an exhibition, right? So what is the offering? What is the type of resources?
What was the proposal?
What was the proposal? How had you shaped the gallery to be able to encourage someone like Jill to be part of it?
Well, I guess... I didn't offer anything. We just liked each other. But I think, I mean, now that you mention it, I think in the end, galleries are the artists they represent. So I think Jill's work, who is really challenging and really put together in a very smart and conscious way, fit with the other artists at the gallery.
Yeah, I would say for sure I felt with the artists already at Labor a communion with them. Some of them I was already friends with, even from the Rijksakademie, from all different countries. And what I love about Labor, not only do I really love so many of the artists in it just as people, but I also am really interested in their practice, and it's deeply considered, I feel, all the work in the gallery, but it's still, it's as well formally beautiful. I think many of the installations can touch on very complex themes, but they're formally considered. I think Pamela, at least in my case, we talk very much about what to include, what not to include. Oh, maybe that's too much, or, you know, so, and that's where the curatorial part of Pamela, I think, really comes in. So it was a gallery that I like recognized. And then because Pamela gets very involved with the artists she works with, I know from the other ones as well, it was important that we understood each other and that we were able to speak. And for instance, with the Barragán archives, I mean, between the like multiple calls between Casa Barragán, the foundation, different curators, the family, Vitra, Pamela, I mean, we were on the phone every day for 2 years. So
Maybe there's a fact that hasn't been mentioned here, although when the project is written about, it generally is, but just so you get a sense, Labor Gallery is actually just across the street from Casa Barragán. And I think that that's actually a very important detail here.
I forgot to say that.
that has to do with learning for you, firstly, of his existence and work, and also the proximity of that. So going back to the actual project of the Barragán Archives of GIL, why don't you describe a little bit about your actual involvement in it? There are so many aspects of this project, and there's something very important, which is who is brokering the project locally, meaning the gallery is not necessarily brokering a sale, but actually brokering a series of relationships that will become fundamental in making that project happen. Everything from the family gathering in Guadalajara to the actual discussion and promotion of the project within the process. So why don't we talk about that? Because actually the next question I think has to be, and before we open it to the public, is I think it's very important to open up a little bit the discussion around your project, the actual contents of the exhibition in Guadalajara or in general, meaning the actual uses that you've done of the personal archive of Barragán. So just tell us a little bit of what does it mean for Labor as a gallery to broker a project like this in the last 3 years?
I'm understanding the word broker as someone that facilitates access to, okay. Well, we were installing Jill's previous show at the gallery, and in one of those moments where you have nothing to do or you have to wait till something happens, I suggested her to go and visit Casa Barragán. And she came back, and she was really moved by the work and the space and everything. And she said something like, oh, it's such a shame that I don't do this kind of practice where I just use images or what is visible. And of course, everybody in Mexico that is familiar with the work of Barragán, we all knew about the fact that the archive left the country in very special conditions. So I mentioned this to Jill, and then we went for lunch with the director of Casa Barragán, and that's how everything started. We heard from her. We heard from her the first time about this story of the archive being a wedding present. We heard it multiple times, actually, from a lot of people.
One.
But she was the first one. And that's when she got obsessed with it.
Yeah.
What else?
Tell us about the process, cómo organizaste.
Well, I think my role as a gallerist and also as a curator is always, first of all, telling the truth to the artist and what you really think if a work is working or not, or I don't know. But also to be 100% supportive with what they do. Like, I'm not going to back off. So the project started being like more and more interesting, and I am also a person that doesn't take no for an answer, so we got along really well. And that's what we do. I mean, that's what we do in terms of dealing with stuff. That's why we are called dealers, I think. Mm-hmm. We just know our capacities, like people that we know that could help us. I started introducing Jill to interesting people that I know that have the capacity to understand the project and get passionate about it and just help us with the process. So I basically gave her my network in Mexico. I was the local. I was the one who knew how things work and could develop at certain point in Mexico. So that was my part.
And it was a real process too, because even when we met with the family and stuff, and we knew that the next step was the government, we didn't even know who in the government to talk to, you know. So there were multiple people also saying, well, I think this person would be even the right person in the government, and then they'd pass us to someone else. And it became a network that just kept expanding. But also, you said something interesting to me about how there's, in this case, within the project, the one piece of the proposal, that the proposal also made the work, because there was this beautiful idea to make the diamond, and then there was like the process to get to there, which kind of created this sort of wave that took us into different places, and people would say different things that was like so inspiring, or and this thing of whether to say don't take no for an answer. It's not this like bratty thing of like, no, I'm gonna. It's the question of like, why no? Why no? What is like, even with System Azure, the decorations of the cameras, it wasn't just that I came as a corporation, that was just to get them to actually talk to me. When I said I was an artist, they were like, we don't work with artists. Like, systematically you don't? Like, what is it about artists that you have a problem with? So once they finally let me through the door, I said, I want to decorate your surveillance cameras attached to your headquarters with rhinestones. And then they said, just as an example, we don't want to do that because we don't want people to see them. And I was like, if you don't want people to see them, you know there's many cameras that are invisible. It's very easy on the architecture to have cameras that don't call attention to themselves. Yours are like 2 feet long and quite wide, like they're very visible. And so then they had to think, and they were like, well, we want the good people not to see them and the bad people to see them. And basically it's the question of, okay, let's unpack that for a second. So these things of no, they're just more of like the red light goes off, and it's just for me like, well, that's interesting. Why is that a problem? But this isn't. Like, and I feel that it's a practice of a way to more deeply understand the world or our world that we accept. And often it's these cliches or banal things. We say, no, we don't. That's not the way things are done, until an artist can come in or someone else and say, like, but why? So that's the thing about the no. And I think that was so much of our conversations was, you know, I asked to sleep at Casa Barragon for a week, which took as long to get permission as the diamond. And it was like, why? Why? What is that line, the visitor of the museum? Where does that change? And then understanding it. And so many times the reasons lead you to even more deeply understand the subject and make artwork from that.
I mean, I think that certainly we're not gonna have time right now, because we'll open it for discussion, for questions. But one of the things that I find important as well, just to mention right now at the end, is that Women with Sombrero, being one of the largest and first iterations of the Barragan archives, just the fact that it deals with the personal archives, meaning that it marks a distinction between, curiously, having access to a private life versus the inaccessibility given to kind of professional, public sort of set of materials that have been cataloged. And my thinking, and as I said, the fine print of the agreement in the proposal which is the exchange or the kind of presentation or acceptance of the engagement ring with the cremation diamond of Barragán for the actual possibility of relocating and presenting more publicly accessible the archives. The fact that this is presented, I would say, as a simple proposal, not one that necessarily comes with a plan. Mm-hmm. I think it's very much the presentation of the project presenting itself as a question, a series of questions to asking who has the authority and who has the access sort of enter into the realms or into the materials that constitute what you can call a legacy, which is a term that you use, or what one can understand just simply as knowledge, no? The knowledge of this or that, whether it's a security camera or the professional archive of an architect. So I think that the questions around accessibility that are presented, and specifically that are staged as a love triangle in the woman with sombrero, or that are presented by the artist using an artistic genre, whether it's the epistolary genre of letter writing, taking on the very exercises or documents of the Barragán personal archives, or actually the one of presenting yourself as a corporate sort of person offering a service to Amsterdam. I think that both of these present the performance of the artist in a very lucid way. So the project in Mexico, for different reasons, has been widely discussed. Widely discussed in the public sphere, and by that I mean discussed in the press and in coffee meetings and in television news, and certainly in the social networks as well, for different reasons. And I think that we can discuss these aspects if you would like, but for sure, the important thing was to understand, I think, the project as it is, and a practice that has been being supported by a gallery, Labor, and through the work of Pamela, that generally involves projects of this nature, projects that involve many people in the realization, what I do think are accomplices, because more their partnerships or collaborators in this process, there's ultimately ulterior motives or other kinds of intentions and the simple sheer force of will in which people participate, meaning there's a little, at times, a little commercial participation, I would say, although that doesn't mean that they're removed from the values that that a market could generate, which are also symbolic capital. So I wanted to see if anyone has questions and whether for the artist, Pamela, or the conversations.
Well, thank you very much for the conversation this morning. It's been wonderful. But I have a question for Jill in terms of, in very, very great introduction, Sophia, of her work. And going back to the Dutch project, it sounds like almost the creation of a persona, a persona where you present yourself, you do something to who you are in order to enter into a situation or to present yourself to an authority. And at the same time, we were having a discussion before the conversation started. We were also talking about the work of Trevor Paglen and how he's somehow able to work with these incredibly private governmental structures and somehow get to be liked by them, like come into their favor. When so many artists present themselves, they present resistance, and then there's this dynamic opposite. And so I'm wondering if you could talk about how your approach is in using a guise, yet at the same time there seems to be an incredible amount of honesty and straightforwardness with it. Thank you.
Yes, well, Trevor is a good friend of mine, actually. We used to be asked to give talks at the same time all the time. So, and I would say from what I know of Trevor is the same for me. Like, the word guise, and they're difficult words because you kind of imagine someone puts on a mask and they're like this totally other person. But even friends of mine who are actors, who talk about acting, they immerse themselves in a role to find like a personal connection with that character. But I would say that's the extreme. I don't feel that's not even a good thing to bring up. But I don't see myself in a guise. Like, I think that different situations require a different presentation of oneself. Like, if you're going to a court of law, like, you're not going to wear a tank top and shorts and, like, talk the way you're talking to your friend sitting on the beach with them. Like, it's a different situation that requires, like, preparation. And I'm, all of the projects I've done and why I think people have collaborated with me, I mean, I had a 3-year commission with the Dutch Secret Service. I got, like, full access into that. And it's because people are like, well, why did they tell you things? I'm like, because I asked them. Because I sat there for like 7 hours in each meeting and really listened and really asked questions. And I'm very, very interested in what how these situations work, why they're working, why they're not working, or any questions that I have. And I often find that coming in with what might seem like an absurd request is almost the only way that people can be like, oh, wait a second, I'm going to take myself out of autopilot and actually, like, think about this, you know? So I just think it would be totally dismissive and disrespectful of any of the people I've worked with if I didn't come in knowledgeable as much as I could of who they are, where they're coming from, and obviously there's much to learn. And the people say to me, a lot of them are like, oh, I don't believe your projects, they're just fiction. I can't tell you how much I wish I were a fiction writer and I could sit down in my studio and make it all up, because it'd be much easier and I wouldn't be calling Pamela at 3 o'clock in the morning. But I think the world and relationships and human relationships are just messy and beautiful and sticky and formal and all these things, and that it's only through them and through these institutions that one can like ask these deeper questions. And again, I feel like the obtuse request is often the way to make suddenly people aware of the situation. And so that's why I love art, and I believe in the object too. I think we are talking about the market or not the market, but you know, in the end, artworks are working on all different levels, but like, I believe that your real approach to the work, whether it's the horses, the tapete, the ring, is its own profound, ideally, experience that, you know, you also come as a viewer and you learn or you don't learn and you take at different levels. So there's all these different ways of speaking. Some are through objects, some are through text, some are through questions, some are just through relationships, right?
I think that in that regard, I mean, there's another question here. So in the meantime that they pass, and one here. I don't know if you want to pass a microphone. Thank you. But I think that the very crystallization of the ideas into objects, whether it's a sculpture of a, you know, of the horse or of the vow in a case, or of the diamond, or of a series of letters, I think that the importance of articulation, meaning that the artist is able to articulate and also verbally, performatively in speech and in writing, which is your case, but also at the same time that the artist is able to crystallize these ideas or those relationships and those so-called accesses sculpturally or visually, is part of the equation of the project, no? Meaning it's not absolutely.
Hello, I'm intrigued by your relationship with lawyers.
Lawyers,
because your legal fees should be astronomical, because lawyers are not known for being very generous with their time. And yet law is so important to what you do, and as you rightly said, you know, copywriting Barragan without the accent means absolutely nothing. Just like Eve Klein, when he got the copyrighted the wrong colour, Eve Klein 191, it makes it look ridiculous. So law is so, so important to you, but you can't be paying full legal fees, can you?
No. The short question. The great, great thing is that sometimes I give artworks, but I usually do that without the lawyer asking me to. It's like, you kind of feel when, okay, this would be nice now. But I would say my same answer to this gentleman was that the lawyers that collaborate with me are really interested in the questions. They get excited about it, you know? And so I've just been very lucky that the lawyers that I've worked with, when they don't know, they're like, oh, that's actually property law. I'm more this kind of, like with the Dutch Secret Service, for instance, that was one of my first times working with like a very powerful law firm in New York. And the Dutch Secret Service, which had commissioned me, then were threatening to put me in jail and confiscate all of my artwork because they said I'd become a national security threat. So I went to this entertainment lawyer because I don't even know how I got to him, but you know, he amassed a whole team and they sat around the table. And for them, this was like, just absolutely fascinating. They were like, you know, even the question then, they're like, well, the first thing we need to do is see your confidentiality agreement with the Dutch Secret Service. And I was like, I don't have one. And they were like, you got full security access, but you don't have an agreement with the Dutch Secret Service. And I was like, no. And he's like, basically, you just won this case. But instead, I said, I was more interested in, like, explain to me the laws they're trying to use against me. And they just found it so thought-provoking that they did it all for free. And that's been generally the way it's worked. In one lawyer I work with, Daniel McLean, he writes about the cases often. So Sternberg Press did a book about the proposal, and he was a main lawyer, and he wrote a very long essay about it, which was exciting for him to do.
And also, if you're aware of his work, he's a lawyer that has been working with artists and specifically artist agreements on a conceptual art historical level. So he brings his knowledge of the law to be able to understand artistic transactions and conceptualism in specific. You know?
Yeah.
Any other question you had?
Yeah, I'd just like to say, first of all, thank you. Thank you for the talk. And I've really found your work fascinating. But I'm curious how you've experienced your first moments of success as an artist, whether it's like the first time you had a show with a good gallery, or I don't know, just how that kind of came about, and maybe like who some of the people were.
Those
that
are two
instrumental.
Different things. The first show with the gallery and success. Success is a very strange word. I think there's the feeling of when you feel like I'll speak for myself, there's the feeling of when I feel like I've made a piece that I feel good about, that's something, or the process of making a work, because it's extremely emotional. And I would say what I love about showing work, whether it's in a gallery or a museum, is that really uncanny feeling of once it's up, stepping back and being like, I made this. Like, it's just always so different once it can be installed in that way and it's public, and it's almost like I get to see it anew. And I also think, and this is another thing about legacy I'm really interested in, that a work that there's works that I did that like I maybe didn't think was a work that I cared about as much, and maybe that was a transitional piece, and then years later you go back to it and you're like, oh, you know, that makes sense to me. Like, even when Sophia was like, I'm going to bring up your manifesto from System Azure, I was like, oh my God, really? Like, I wrote that so long ago, and I remember writing it, and I'd forgotten that it said, let me look at the ring on your finger. And that brought back like everything I was reading at the time. And so I think success is very unfortunately, that feeling is short-lived. If I indeed feel it, I go straight to the next thing of like, well, what if I ask a question a different way? Or so it's just a process, you know? But yes, I think that there's so many different things in that, I would say. But yet showing work, I think, is a really amazing kind of mirror that's a non-mirror, because it's not that one-to-one. It is a fascinating process.
I think that like a curatorial approach to Jill's work, I would say that it was very that her participation in the Liverpool Biennale was very successful. Meaning, mm-hmm. it gave a lot of attention to that through that project. It gave a lot of attention to who is this artist, how was she able to do such a project, which was pretty much being directed again through the surveillance cameras of the city. Blindfolded through there. So I think that project was successful, you know, again, from a curatorial viewpoint, I'm like, oh, the project was successful in giving visibility to an artist at the same time as to a type of artistic practice that didn't have so much visibility then, I would say, and to a subject matter that was of interest to many artists, but that became of interest significantly around the following number of years, which was surveillance. So I think that's a, you know, I don't think that it was a commercial success, but or maybe it was. I don't know.
It was. It's in the Whitney Museum collection and other collections.
Great.
So
there you go. Yeah. So I think that there's just certain projects that, like that one, that I would say was an important successful version. I don't know if there's any more questions in the room. Yeah, and if there's none, I think that it's about time we wrap up. So thank you so much for your participation here.